Now just looking to the Lord, because He's God and He's the one who does these things, and recognizing that it's not of ourselves, but that it comes out of the realms of that which He supplies, and He does it by His own good grace and for His own good pleasure. We can then begin to be in expectation of having something that would come to us, not by any works of righteousness which we would do, but because Father has chosen to do it. Now what I'm going to do tonight is, by the help of the grace of God, I'm going to begin to lay out some things for you that I hope will take a little bit of pressure off of you. Okay? First and foremost, God's the one who planned all of this. And now all we need to do is cooperate with Him in it. Just let God be God, because He's God. He's just God Almighty. And I'm going to open up with a verse of Scripture that is pretty, it's a profound verse of Scripture found in Romans chapter 12 and verse 4. And it needs to become something that people recognize in the context of an unlimited provision, an opportunity to have faith to move mountains and to do anything and walk in every dimension of all the fullness of God. And here we read that in this verse of Scripture, it says, "Let no man think more highly of himself than he ought to think, but let every person think soberly according as God hath dealt to him and dealt to every man a measure of faith." Everything that we do in God, we walk and function in these things in the Spirit by the realm, in the realms of faith. It's all by faith. It's an active working grace of the power of God in our lives. Now listen, I want to talk to you about people who never ask or really beg God to do anything for them. I just, for just a minute, just give you some highlights, and they did things that go beyond that which people who have maybe spend their whole life fasting and praying, not a lot happen. I just want to talk to you about the grace of God. And I want to talk to you about a grace of God, a divine appointment. I want to talk to you about special gifts the Father gives, as well as an open door of opportunity that everybody can come in and receive everything that Jesus has. And it's very important for us to understand this. It's better, very important for us to submit to it, okay, and embrace it. William Branham never asked for anything. And he never really fasted and prayed, as far as I know of or he ever told. But one day a power of God came upon him that was absolutely phenomenal. I mean, where that everybody, I mean, just everybody was healed in his meetings, where the audible voice of God was heard in his meetings, where the glow of God's glory, light shining on him, pictures taken of him, where he'd have visions and he'd go, like when he was in Finland, the Lord showed him a boy, gave him a picture of a boy, spoke of it, I think it was somewhere in Georgia or somewhere, Missouri, something, of a boy he saw laying dead. And he gets to Finland, sure enough, there's a wreck, there's a boy laying dead in the street, been dead for around 30 minutes or so. He goes and he raises the boy from the dead, says, he just basically raised him from the dead, saying, "Lord Jesus, I thank you that you showed me this vision of this boy here laying dead in the street, having been crushed by a car and every bone in his body broken and his organs smashed, that you showed me in a vision that you had raised him up, and because you showed me in the vision, God caused me to understand that it doesn't matter what goes on around here, it's going to happen. It doesn't matter who's got faith and who doesn't have faith, it's going to happen, because that's what you've already ordained to do." And the boy gets up and takes off running around. And that night in the meeting in Finland, this is back in the early 50s now. People came over, the military guard from Russia came over, and as he's walking into the building, saluted him and said, "We can serve a God who do things like that." And we're just talking about special graces. We're talking about a man who basically. And I really like for you to think about this and understand this, because it's also a dynamic of the relationship concerning what I just read to you, and I'm going to talk more about it so that hopefully you more fully embrace it and understand it, where he would say, "Yeah, I know, it just looks like I'm standing up here and just talking like anybody else. I am, because I'm waiting for the angel to come. I'm waiting for the anointing, the mantle of the Spirit of the Lord to come upon me." Having an understanding of that, and having that contrast between what you and I would do out of our own efforts and ambitions is very important. I don't get up and minister till I feel the anointing. I prepare myself before I get to the meeting to where that I step over into a realm of divine glory. I don't preach without the anointing, without the mantle. The mantle has to come upon me. Similarly, I could talk about Catherine Kuhlman. She would say, "Lord, I can't go out and face those people as a mere human being. I can't go. I can't walk out there and them just see me. Lord, let your anointing come upon me. let your glory overwhelm me, let your glory overshadow me. And she would just do that. And there's lots of testimonies to where people standing on the sideline would watch a transformation take place in her, going from just kind of a shy, awkward, kind of generous, gregarious person, but then to a bold person with a great anointing upon her. I mean, people talk about the very preachers, ministers talk about the very atmosphere change that would take place around her at that juncture. And, you know, people that initially didn't even like her, like you've heard me talk about the story from the pastor, Assemblies of God pastor up in Central California, Northern California, actually San Jose, who didn't really appreciate Catherine Coleman at all. He was appointed to take care of her, and he went and picked her up at the airport, took her ultimately to the green room, where she, you know, to the room, ready room, where she was getting ready for the meeting, and sat there waiting for her because he was supposed to usher her out to the platform. And it was all just something that he more or less just, you know, did out of obedience to his nomination, if you would. But then he talks about how that he was sitting there and all of a sudden he felt the atmosphere change. He began to experience the presence of God like he had never experienced in his life. And he was a matured preacher, been preaching for many years. It changed his whole concept of who this person was. And because different people have different doctrinal beliefs about whether women could preach. And, you know, even today, there's a lot of people who don't believe that women have the right to preach or even function in the anointing. It's just the way it is. I mean, it's just been that way. And I don't agree with that. But nonetheless, bottom line of it is, it's just been that way. And I understand where they come from. I understand the scriptural perspective in which they present their case. But nonetheless, you know, my point to you is that you need to understand how to step into that realm. You need to understand. We need to all understand how to be faithful with what God has given us. He says to us, let every one of us be sober. And not think more highly of ourselves than we ought to think, but understand the measure of faith that has been given to us. Understand that dimension of grace. Paul said, I am what I am by the grace of God. Paul wasn't fasting and praying that he would have, you know, a miracle ministry, signs and wonders. Huh? He didn't have an encounter. God sovereignly appointed. I mean, I have had the opportunity to be around a lot of people and say, what do you believe happened to you? And had other people that I know of say the same thing. But what do you believe happened to you? What is the milestone point that caused this great mantle of the Spirit to come upon you to where these miracles, signs, and wonders take place? And every one of them say, I don't know. It just happened. I woke up one day and it was there. It was the divine appointment of God. And we have to understand that. And we have to understand that also in the balance, because some people just said, well, it's just what God's done and that's it. And just a few people are going to get that mantle and have that anointing and be able to do that. And that's why only a few people do it, you know, where God sovereignly just does it. It's on them. Okay. And then all the rest of us just got to be kind of like marginalized. But that's not the case at all. But there is a place to embrace every dimension of this. And then understand how to faithfully walk out with God and the things that He's given us, and be able then through faithful, being faithful in the things which we've received, now act to be able to have more, to do more, to access more, to grow and become sensitive. I think that what happens to people is they'll come into a struggle, they begin to doubt, they'll begin to have two opinions, they'll be praying and ask. I remember a preacher, young preacher, he's been a preacher now for probably 40 years, but I knew him before he was a preacher. What a character he was. You know, crazy, crazy hot rod, just drove cars like they were, you know, something other than cars with four wheels. He always drove them on the side, you know. And he never drove his motorcycle rarely on two wheels. It was always on one. He was just a wild guy. And the Lord radically transforms him. And now he's going to walk on the water. That's just who he is. He was always that way with everything he'd always done. Now he's saved. He's going to walk on the water. First thing, right off the bat, we're walking on the water. And then he got severely disappointed, you know. And because he went out there, he practiced a long time. He'd walk out there just walking, and boom, just keep sinking down to his knees. And then go back out and try again, bless his heart. You know, and, then people get into this struggle because Now they say, well, you know, wait a minute. Why didn't this work for me? God said, I believe, and I know I believe, and I know I'm moved in faith, and I'm doing this thing, and, you know, why isn't it happening? Now there's something, first of all, something's either wrong with me, and I got to get something right and something fixed, or something's wrong with God, and he's got to get something fixed. It just gets so convoluted, and it becomes a struggle then, you know. It becomes a place of doubt and unbelief. It's not a place of faithfully being thankful for the things that we've received, you know. I believe when I look at people like, you know, there's so many to talk about. And let me just take two that are not, you know, that are in heaven right now. William Brennan, Catherine Coleman. And I like to use a model of a guy and a model of a lady of whom God used in mighty ways. Because I can tell you, by and large, it is very similar for most everybody that I've read about or that I've personally known. That there is this dynamic of where they didn't really think much of themselves, didn't really expect much of themselves. I mean, William Branham had a seventh grade education, and he didn't really expect much of himself, and didn't, you know, he was just appreciative to be along. He was just happy to be there, you know, as happy to get the door for you kind of thing, you know, just happy to be in the number. Somehow God's called him to preach now. This is an amazing thing. And, you know, he didn't say hardly any words correctly. He didn't speak English properly. You know, he's half, you know, quarter, half Native American, just ignorant guy from Indiana. Basically, we would look at him as just a country bumpkin. Huh? And the Lord comes to him. An angel of the Lord appears to him and says, I'm going to anoint you. And it's the rest is history. I mean, there's nobody operated in the gifts of the Spirit. In modern times, like it began to happen with William Branham, 1946. He literally, God utilized him to kick off the great healing revival. I mean, everybody's sitting there with light shining on him, huh? Audible voice of God is heard. I mean, it's on tape. You can go and listen to it right now. You can hear the audible voice of God. As he's telling the devil to leave and setting people free from sickness and disease. Pretty radical stuff, eh? And then the Lord just did it. He didn't fast, didn't pray for it. The Lord did. And his doctrine, his doctrine was out there. I tried to listen to an hour and 40 minutes of one of his messages today that he gave in 1958. And it's like, wow. The Lord does not anoint based upon knowledge of the word. He anoints. Someone who learns to be sensitive. Someone who will receive. According as he wills. The Holy Ghost divides individually according as he wills. And I want him to will to divide everything to me. I want it all. I want every part of it. I do not want to come, you know, short of anything. But I understand that if you're going to strive for mysteries, you're going to have to learn to strive lawfully for them. You know, you're going to have to learn how to be thankful that you're not mute. Hallelujah. That you can speak and say, thank you, Jesus. I mean, that's got to become big to you. Instead of always just down on yourself, I mean, I'm just like, I'm taking up the drag back here. You know, praise God, I can still see the camp of the Lord in sight, but I'm way behind. I mean, you know, that stuff has got to be eliminated. And praise and thanksgiving to what Father chooses to do has got to be big to us. We can't walk around sulking. You didn't choose me, you know. Why didn't he chose you already? You're here in the company. You're the redeemed of the Lord. Praise God, he's chose you already. He's appointed you with the greatest thing, you know, that could possibly be imagined. You know, you don't hear Paul talking about how desperate he is to do signs and wonders and miracles. You hear him talk about how desperate he is to win Jesus. You hear him talk about how desperate he is to have the resurrection from the dead. You hear about how desperate he is to be found in Christ Jesus and not be counted a castaway. Just like the signs, wonders, and miracles, that just came naturally. God just gave it to him. It was just his. And then he comes on and tells us, look, this is how this works. I'm pondering what he was talking about. Huh? God just finds us. God finds a guy out there who's basically plowing the field. Elisha. He tells Elijah, out of all the multitudes, we don't even know that We don't even know that he was of the nation of Israel. We don't even know that for sure. We just use a Tishbite. Whatever that is. And he gets this other guy, Elisha, and he's a character. And, come on, the bald-headed guy. Are you listening to me here? Jesus goes up into a mountain. He's got a lot of people standing around him. And the Lord says, I want you to anoint 12 apostles. I'm going to tell you, Luke was there. Barnabas was there. Others were there. Of the 120 that was there, I'm sure a lot of them was standing around with the 12 when they didn't make first ring. As it were, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. You know? It's like the big disappointment. It was like, you're not on the team. But yeah, you are on the team. You get to be a part of the company. You get to come follow me. These I just given them a special anointing. Ooh. These I'm gonna send out first. And everybody who doesn't sulk and get all upset about the whole program, you're going out second. Because that's the 70 others also. Now we're up to 82. And that's basically the 120. Because when you take them and all the extra family members surrounding them, I mean, there's really not room for too many newcomers. Are you with me? And now we got to get comfortable with this. As we are striving for masteries, as we are stepping out, believing God, saying, Lord, I know that you want to use me. I'm desperate about it. See, the balance has to be a hunger and a passion and a desperation at the same time of an acceptance and a praise and a thanksgiving for all that Father is doing. I approve of what you've done, Lord. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
When you begin to honor what God's doing, you're saying, Lord, I approve what you've done. I approve of what you've given to me. I'm excited that you have entrusted me with this glorious testimony of salvation. And what happens is then all of a sudden you begin now to get rid of those dynamics of struggle that is ultimately going to give room and place to unbelief and doubt and wavering about the whole thing. And you're just happy to be you. You're just happy to be right there and counted in the number, you know. And wanting to be somebody else and feeling like somehow you've been left out. That is a terrible feeling. You weren't chosen. You've been chosen. You were chosen. That's how you hear. Hallelujah. You did not choose him. He chose you. Now, people, what I'm just saying sounds very obvious and simple. It happens to be a way, though, the way in which you begin to move forward in God. It happens to be the way in which you begin to agree with God. Two cannot walk together unless they agree. God's happy about what he's given you, and you're all upset about it. You're not going to get far until you kind of come into an agreement, with him. Huh? And then you say, well, I'm settling out. Nuh-uh. You hungry and thirsty for more, happy and excited about what all he's done, settling out nothing. You've been made a son of God. What's that settling out? You've given more than you possibly, you've been given more than you deserve. I've been given far more than I deserve. What are you talking about? Settling out. It's just that we got to get all the ideas that are inspired by the realms of pride out of it, all the ambition out of it, all the self-centeredness out of it, all the egotism, all the competition, all the comparisons. Those things hold us back, people. They hold us back. I mean, it's wonderful when you begin to be just so accepted and beloved. When you're so accepted, you can be so confident. You can be so confident and so happy that now you come to understand that in this place of rest and just, wow, you know, I'm accepted. I'm exactly where I'm supposed to be kind of thing. Now you can be sensitive to the moving of the Holy Ghost in your life. Now you can begin to see things that otherwise you being all bogged down with doubt and unbelief and concern and worry and sense of rejection and failure and left out and hadn't accomplished enough. Anything or much has blinded you. See, the things that are around us blind us. Our own mind, the occupation of wrong thinking deafens us. It hardens our heart to be able to receive from God. Doubt and unbelief is a terrible realm. Confusion is a terrible realm. Disappointment goes right along with it. Disappointment is a realm of discouragement, just like it, and it's fathered by fear or mothered by it, either way, whatever you want us to call. Say, it's a part of a lie. It's a part of a lie system, okay? Satan's the father of lie, and what he does within the framework of a lie is he creates an atmosphere of fear. Fear is nothing but a stinking lie. What do you got to be afraid about? Huh? That's something that is very difficult for people to deal with. And now that comes all the discouragement, all the disappointment, all the insecurity, all the inferiority, all the things that make you feel somehow that you're not, you know, in the number. Well, you know, that if you can step out of the realm of needing the approval of men, hallelujah, and now you got the approval of God in Christ Jesus, and you understand the boldness that you have by the blood of Jesus, the access you have by the blood of Jesus, the fact that the blood has cleansed you and washed you, the water of the Word has made you everything that Father wants you to be, the power, empowerment of the Holy Ghost is set right down on you to establish you, to lead you, guide you, and God knows exactly what He's doing with you.
Yeah.
Against maybe your agreement. No, Lord, I'm supposed to be over here doing this. Well, if you were, guess what? You would be over there doing that. Now, I'm not saying that there aren't things that hold us back and keep us from those moments in time and divine appointments that Father has for us, places that we were supposed to go in God, and we just simply missed the boat. We missed the train. The train arrived, but we weren't at the station. So we got to wait for the next train. That's tough. Back, 150 years ago, if they missed the stagecoach, the stage master said, "Don't worry, there's another one coming by in 45 days." Okay, if we missed an appointment today, then we're got to wait maybe 30 minutes, and we feel like this. Yeah, we're gonna make it. This is just ridiculous. This is poor service. You call this customer service? I'm never flying this airline again. I've had to wait 2 hours. Okay, so we've got all these different ideas and relativisms about, you know, what we should be doing, when we should be doing it, how things should go. But we're going to have to come understand that Father is in charge, and we're going to have to let God be God. When you do, you're going to find something that happens in your life. You're going to become gloriously aware of the presence of the Lord Jesus who does the work. I think one of the beautiful things that I always admired about William Branham was this. Even after the miraculous, we're talking about intense, dramatic raisings of the dead, you know, like a crushed young boy. It's intense, dramatic raisings of the dead. I mean, just amazing stuff. Paraplegics. The blind, the deaf, the mute, the incredible word of knowledge. I mean, one day they were going to question him about his doctrine, and the Lord said, "Well, they're going to question you, the full gospel businessmen, going to question you about your doctrine today." And they've got 350 experts there, and just tells them. He says, and gives them their names, and then tells them, and then Tommy Hicks and I think it's one of the other leaders. He was more. Or I don't remember exactly who it was. I know Tommy Hicks was in the midst of it because he's saying, "Tommy, why don't you just take the service for me?" But at any rate, he tells into the detail. First of all, the room that you've rented to do this in, it's not going to be available. And the guy says, "Wait a minute, what are you talking about? We've already paid for it. It's available." He says, "It's not going to be available. The room that we will be in looks like this. Here's where everybody's going to be seated." He describes everything. He tells about every detail of everything that's going to go down, so that when the moderator gets there and all of this all unfolds 3 days later, he says, "Well, I know what's going to go on here today, but let me tell you before we get started that here's what happened 3 days ago. William Branham was able to tell me exactly all of the changes that took place that we've all gone through here today that was absolutely impossible changes. He told me the seating arrangement where everybody would be seating. He told me every detail that is here." So keep that in mind when you're asking your questions. William Branham walks out of the platform. He opens up his Bible. He says, "Listen, I've got a seven-year... I've got an education. I went to seventh grade. So I have a 7-year education. You guys are theologians. You guys are THDs, PhDs. And I just challenge anybody, come up here and stand right beside me, right here where the angel of the Lord stands by me with your Bible open, and let's talk about this." And no one moved. No one moved. Because that's, first of all, you're gonna, in that kind of context, you think about, talk about, you feel the anointing, you're feeling some terror. Because there's nobody, think about it, the power gifts like that, the display of power like that, come on now. And one of the things that I always appreciated about him, even in that place of boldness, with that kind of anointing, with that kind of display of power, it's one thing to go and flow and function in the vocal gifts. It's another thing to function in the power gifts. Power gifts is a whole nother display of, you know, people don't have really much room to sit there and scratch their head. They're going to have some room, but especially when the dead are being raised and everybody knows it's dead, especially when those kinds of phenomenal words of knowledge are given. Okay, those kinds of details. And he always constantly just simply said, I'm not doing this. Jesus, he's here and Jesus is doing this. And we're asking Jesus to do this. Listen, that's something that's a shift from then to modern day. Modern day, you hear a lot of people say, it's what we have. We're doing it. It's ours. Okay? Well, wait a minute. We need to be making sure, truly that, yeah, the power of God is flowing out of us. We need to be recognizing Jesus who's here doing the work. He said, I'm going to be with you always. I'll confirm my word with signs and wonders and miracles. And watching that kind of recognition and humility work is something that is so outstanding within the framework of those who function in the greatest displays of the power of God, which we really don't have any examples of. Not on that level, not in this generation, not now. Okay? And I praise God. Don't get me wrong. I've been in Reinhardt's meetings. I've watched what's taking place. You know, when you got 800,000 people there, you know, and 8,000 people get healed, come on. 8,000 people getting healed is pretty miraculous, right? But look at the percentage. Are you with me?
Yeah.
You know? I mean, even if you got 10%, 8,000 people. But I mean, 8,000 people having dramatic miracles is pretty profound. I've not only watched that, but I've watched people who've been anointed of God. Now, I didn't know A.A. Allen personally. However, I do know personally people who knew A.A. Allen and were with A.A. Allen. And, you know, God gave him a special anointing, and truly he gave him a special anointing. And yes, A.A. Allen fasted for 40 days. He wasn't going to come out of the fast until a special anointing came upon him. He received a special anointing. But A. Allen didn't take long, and A. Allen started slipping into alcoholism. And I know the person who went and got him out of the hotel room, dead. He died from alcohol in a hotel room. I know the person personally who went and got him out of that room. And you think, well, how do you mean? What's going on? How can signs and wonders and miracles be working? How? What? You know, I know people personally also who had mass evangelist crusades. I know them personally. I know them. Have had mass evangelism crusades, signs, wonders, and miracles, death section here, blind see, and they not walking right with God. And I'm going to tell you, in a bad way, not walking right with God. Okay? To where that it's just like they, you know, go couple months right with the Lord, and then they slip into sin. And I'm talking about adultery, drugs, alcohol, full blown. Huh? Repent, get back up, and do it again. I know one man that my father knew, and he was in Kenya. He broke Kenya open in the 20s and the 30s when they basically were still all running around naked. And he'd give them clothes, and his team would give them clothes, and they'd know where everybody came from because they could just follow the clothes to whatever village they came from. Because they'd take the clothes to the village, and put the clothes on in the village to come meeting. And the meeting's over, you know, on the way home, they're deburdening themselves and getting rid of the clothes. So they'd go follow them home, pick out the clothes, you know, you hear me?
Yes.
And so that they could get them dressed before the meeting tomorrow night. But this minister, he fell into extreme immorality with Kenyan women. And he would repent, cry out to God and repent. And then he would get out in the meeting, signs, wonders, and miracles. To cause to turn Kenya, it broke Kenya wide open. Such astounding miracles, astounding salvations. Thousands upon thousands and tens of thousands, you know. And it kept going on, and one day he died I mean, he died and I'm sure he went to hell. One day he was in the very act and he was bitten by a spider that kills you quickly. He's in the very act and bitten by a spider that takes you out in like minutes. It's so toxic kind of thing. Dead, died in sin, went to hell. Somebody said, did A.A. Allen go to hell? My goodness, he died in sin. Come on, what are you talking about? He's completely out of his mind, out of his gourd. You know what I'm saying? And so when you try to start thinking about all these dynamics of things, you go, wait a minute, I can't. You figure that out. I can't figure it out. Nobody can figure it out. It's just understanding. You know, I don't understand how that Samson was able to do what he was able to do. Because he's in the model of that and in an example of that. All I can tell you is about an anointing and a favor that God places on a person to do special acts of grace that he appoints and has nothing to do with anything other than what he appointed to do. And then look at what they did with it. Huh? Somebody said, oh, when I finally get over the threshold of being qualified, then I'm going to be able to move in the anointing. And right now I just got to praise God because, you know, I'm not, you know, he can't trust me with it. Well, that's a wrong mentality, man. I'm not saying that. And that's why I just went through this whole long list of bad stuff to say it ain't got nothing to do with that. It has to do with being faithful to him in a relationship with him. It has something to do with, it happens to be that the Lord has opened up the door. This is what the Word of God very clearly and plainly tells us, is that the Lord has opened up the door for everybody to come in and do. Anyone who believes can do these works and greater works. It's a powerful verse of Scripture that opens up the door to everyone. And it really, you know, because then you've got to take that and, you know, I've heard people get up and preach, these signs follow them to believe. If you do not have these signs, then you are not a believer. And then all of a sudden, you're not saved. If you haven't cast out devils, spoke with new tongues, had authority over the serpent, over the poison of the adder and the poison of you know, the drink, huh? And laid hands on somebody and they recovered, you're not saved. Well, no, hold up. You can't take one verse of Scripture at the exclusion of them all. We have to understand every verse of Scripture in the context of the whole Word of God and the whole counsel of God. And there are many things that we don't understand, but this is what we do know. We do know that God is faithful, that he loves us, that he's opened up the door of access for all of us. He said, everybody come on in. You, everybody, I'm telling you, all of you, you can be strengthened by the Spirit of the Lord and you can step over into the realm of functioning in all the fullness of God. I mean, that's a powerful verse of Scripture in Ephesians 3. That's Ephesians 3:19, and you know the verse of Scripture that I quoted, John 14:12. Anyone who believes these works which I do shall you do, and also in greater works than these, and you know, just a host of other verses of Scripture of this invitation to come and function in this divine power and this divine glory, this open door, this opportunity, where Paul says, the manifestation of the Holy Ghost is given to everyone. Well, then it is. And if you quit struggling with whatever it is you're struggling with, you will understand that too. Little things can alter your whole perception of life. Tragedy can really alter your perception of life. Huh? Little events can make you more sensitive or more hardened to what's really always been there. And this is the dynamic that goes into play. And I'm going to tell you right now, you listen to me, because the bottom line of the majority of all of this is comes down to one something very, very simple. It's called the realm of faith. That's it. It's just understanding how that doubt, wavering, double-mindedness is so opposed to these things of faith. I mean, and why is it? You know, I asked the Lord one time, I said, Lord, do you just pick people who are just really just stupid? And that's the only folks that you can use because everybody else is so stuck on their own human mentality. You know, and then the Lord says, no, I get Paul's too. Huh? He gives us an example in his word. Hallelujah. Huh? I get Paul's too. But how many of them are available? I want to be available in every way. I want to have that same. I want to understand this hunger of relationship in a greater way that is expressed by Paul. And in that, there's something far bigger This hunger in relationship, this hunger in knowing Him is something far bigger than all the outworkings. The inworking is far bigger than the outworking. Are you listening to me? That the intimacy with Him, the knowing Him, that the willingness to please Him is far, far bigger. It's far bigger. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Now, what I want you to understand is I want you to understand the realms of faith. Just be sober. You know, here, you know, Paul opens up Romans chapter 12. He says, for I say through the grace given unto me to every man that is among you, do not think of yourself more highly than you ought to think, but think soberly according to as God hath dealt to every man the measure of faith. For as we have many members in one body, and all members do not have the same office, so we being many are one body in Christ Jesus, and every one members one of another, having then gifts differing according to the grace that is given to us. Hello. Have grace that is given to us. I need, you need, we need to get real excited and real thankful about the grace that is given to us and quit comparing ourselves among ourselves and recognize, wait a minute, there is a greater flow. All I need to do is get happy about what I got. Then you're going to walk around in joy unspeakable. Huh? You know, it's a terrible thing to have a move of God to smile. You know what? It's just terrible. The God's people, the only people on the planet, they have to have a sovereign move of God to be able to smile. Everybody else can just be happy, but we're all. You know, that's got to cease, because that stuff, that is a sign of oppression. It's a demonic oppression that comes by way of doubt and unbelief and things that are convoluting the relationship. Disappointments, discouragement, wrong premises, wrong expectations. What is your expectation? I mean, I stood here on Wednesday night and I was praying for a particular individual. And then I heard something in the spirit, and I wasn't only speaking to the individual, but I was speaking to everybody. And I said, you should make a list of what it takes to make you happy. I knew what needed to be on that list. It didn't need it. We're not looking for 4 or 5 or 6 or 7 things. And if you're looking for 4 or 5 or 6 or 7 things, just forget about it. Your heart's divided. That's two opinions. That's diakritos. That's wavering. That's doubt. That's wrong affections. You know, I had just been ministering about, if you want to move in this realm, set your affections on things above. Huh? Hallelujah. Ha-ha. God, let God be God. He'll come on you. He'll show you how to be something more than you are if you learn how to wait on Him. And that manifest presence of God and that mantle, even as we heard an expression, William Branham, where he said, I'm just waiting for the angel. Yeah, you can see that I'm just, you know, I'm like anybody else right now. I can't do anything else. And I don't have any ability to move in any gifts of spirit till the angel. Oh, the angel just got here. And then he starts to call words of knowledge. Someone over here, you got cancer, and come here right you. Oh, and your name is, and he'll lay it out there. Come over here. This is what God's going to do. Huh? To know that dynamic, because that's the relationship of living in the Spirit and being led by the Spirit and walking in the Spirit. And I've got to come to know that, and I've got to hunger to know that. Meanwhile, all the time saying, thank you, Father, that you chose me, that you brought me here, that I'm in you, that I'm kept by your power, oh God. You know, and there has to be both. Even though it may seem like somewhat of a paradox to some people, it's not. Many things in God seem a paradox. Because it's both. It's needed to be both. Hallelujah. Look, there's a couple big enemies. Okay? There's a couple big enemies. It's going to mess with me flowing in the anointing. If I'm mean to my wife, it's going to mess with me flowing in the anointing. And it's just going to mess with us. Sin and unbelief and those things mess with you flowing in the anointing. Don't have them. Speaking bad about someone else, even just casual, it's going to affect the anointing. It's going to affect the flow. He said, there's certain things that I know is going to affect the flow. I'm not going to allow it. But I'm going to tell you what, if I do allow it, I know how to get past it. Huh? However, I believe that it also has a restriction, has a limitation, because I watched as William Branham's America ministry took a nosedive. as he began to become more relentless and more intense about having to espouse his three major doctrines. And everybody gathered around him, and he'd preach fiery for 2-3 hours on his major doctrine. But there wasn't the level of signs and wonders and miracles when he would just get up there and talk about Jesus and how he's waiting on the anointing. That's when he was doing that, and he would tell later on in life, well, he did that because he was agreeing to participate with all these ministers, and the last thing that he wanted to do was create strife, because he knew that if he created strife, the anointing wouldn't function. Very good. Very good. Hello? Yes. Catherine Coleman took a nosedive. Why did she take a nosedive? Because she did something that defiled her conscience in a marriage. Huh? And what happened? For 10 years, it took her 10 years to recover. What was she up? What was she down with? She was down with a bad conscience. That's worse than a cold any day. She was down with a bad conscience. That's worse than a head cold. And it lasted for 10 years. A defiled conscience. She couldn't have boldness. She couldn't have access. She wasn't able to just move in that place of feeling loved and accepted and having that boldness and that confidence. She was being oppressed by this thing. She got past it. And now there's the glory again. Now she can move out again in signs, wonders, miracles. A lot of, once again, it's convoluted by us allowing things that create within us something that violates our acceptance in the Beloved, our love relationship, how much He loves us. I don't care how you feel about Him. He loves you. Amen. I don't care what you've done. He loves you. Amen. When you were enemies, alienated by wicked works, God loved you. He commended His love towards you. Hallelujah. See, that's why I say I can get past it. Because I know, hallelujah, I know how to repent. Yes. I know how to get my sins removed from me as far as the east is from the west. How to send them back to the devil where they cannot return. Hallelujah. And I know how to then end that place in having confidence towards God. Hallelujah. Begin to dorobastarene. What I do is I flow in the Holy Ghost. I pray in the Spirit until the transition comes. I have a transition of the atmosphere. You can practice this. You can give yourself to this, to literally just enjoy Him. If I was thinking about transition in the atmosphere, blah, 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 I would get nothing. I got the wrong expectation. But when it's flowing through me in a relationship with Him, and all it is about Him and just yielding to Him, there's a transition in the atmosphere. It's the difference between the struggle of man and what I want to accomplish and what I'm trying to get the genie in the bottle to do. When I'm trying to get God to perform for me versus just being loved. If you dwell in love, you dwell in God. And that's the biggest transition some of us have got to make. I got to quit feeling like I'm not loved. Somebody said, it's father abuse. My dad wasn't loving. Forget about that, man. Get over yourself. Hello. He did the best he could. Leave him alone. Get over yourself. It ain't his fault. It's your fault. Get your thumb out of your mouth. Quit drooling. Look to God. It ain't about something your dad's going to come hug you, kiss you, talk to you. Now you're going to be able to have a good relationship with God. That is ridiculous. The only thing that hinders us from a relationship with Father is demon spirits. Not whether or not your mom or your dad did what they needed to do for you, or your brother or your sister or your high school teacher or whoever else. I mean, it's just crazy stuff. This is a dynamic of just believing God's love for you, not your dad's love for you. I just can't believe God's love for me because I had such a terrible dad. Dad has nothing to do with the Bible. It doesn't say you can believe the love of God if you can get things right with your dad. Dads, remember this. If you're not real careful with your kids, they're never going to be able to believe them. It's just not in the equation. And we got to make sure we're not allowing tricks of the enemy to shut us down. Because really the biggest transition is this love realm. And then the faith works by the love. And then we just recognize, wait, Father has given me something. I've got something. Manifestation of the Spirit's been given to everyone. Everyone. The Lord, the Holy Spirit has come, and He divides individually to everyone according to as He wills. And I'm like, reel it on me, oh God. And I just begin to go to thanking Him. I thank Him for everything He's doing. And I'm going to tell you right now, if you don't understand how to honor the anointing and love and appreciate the anointing and honor what Father honors, you're going to mess up. You're going to violate worse things in the Spirit than anything you can imagine. Huh? Anytime I've ever seen God using anybody, I'm happy about it. I'm happy about it. I'm just happy. I mean, when you got the Word of God in your mouth, you got a word of prophecy. I mean, but if you stand up in the middle of the meeting and say, Mary was the mother of Jesus, and Judas betrayed Him, you'd have to bring us along in that, because you're going to be a distraction. It's the Word of God. But I mean, what on earth are you saying now? Mary was the mother of Jesus, and Judas betrayed Him. I mean, what does that mean? And a lot of folks do that because there's an ambitious thing going on. I've got to get this. I've got to be this. And I've got to just step out. And there they are, my friend Bennett. I'm walking on the water. You're sinking, buddy. It ain't working that way. You're trying too hard. Relax. Rest. You're accepted. You don't have to prove nothing to us. We like you more now than before you said anything. Or we want you more then. Or whatever. You know what I'm saying? Now we still like you because of the grace of God. After you gave us the great revelation that Mary is the mother of Jesus and Jesus is China. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Just relaxing. Just being so thankful for the anointing. Just honoring it and loving it and being so blessed by it. Jealousy? No. Covetousness? Fine. I want that in my life too. It's beautiful. And I want that in my life too. Fine. Covet the spiritual gifts. Huh? Hallelujah. Kapatora sipia tatanania. Haramamose. I mean, you know, if you try to look for explanations, it could be that, and I don't know this, I'm just saying this, it could be that Father just sovereignly anoints certain people just to let everybody know that it's available. You know, because people just start getting discouraged. No, this really is available. Look, well, how did you get that? Well, I don't really know, but I'm proof positive that the Word of God is accurate. And let me show you in the Bible, it says you can have it too. Hallelujah. I think it's very possible too. I'm going to say this. I think it's very possible. We need the gifts of the Spirit. We need the ministry that functions in gifts of the Spirit. And I think it may be very possible too that God has sovereignly anointed people, just like He did the 12, to go and disperse these things in the Spirit. Because Paul said, you know, I'm going to come and I'm going to make up your lack and supply those things which are lacking in your faith, you know. And he talks about how that, you know, there's that, you know, that impartation of the gifts of the Spirit through the laying on of hands and through the ministry gift. And could be that many people have been laid up. They've been sovereignly anointed by God. Just go lay hands on everybody so that that could be more dispersed, as it were, through the connectivity of the body of Christ. Huh? I know that strife and schism and divisions. I mean, Paul said it. Look, guys. Here's what he's saying. When he says, some say I'm Apollos, some say I'm a Paul, and some say I'm a Peter or Cephas. He said, are you not carnal, walk as mere men? You know what he's saying? He's saying you're a bunch of meatheads. You know? And that isn't too far off, okay? It's not too far off. He's saying you're stuck in a realm. You should have actually been here. There's a lot of things the Lord wanted to teach you, okay? And you weren't here. And so you listen to me. You have to watch the video as soon as you get your hands on it. You're not the only one, but there was a couple of people that the Lord spoke to me before the meeting tonight. Some things He wants you to do. You got to make sure that you put God first. I know you people are running late because you've been working hard, but I'm going to tell you right now, what's most valuable to you is where you put your efforts, what you want more than anything else, you know. Come on. But at any rate, what Paul is saying is he's saying, you've now locked yourself into a place where you're not sensitive to the Holy Ghost. You're walking as mere men instead of walking as spiritual men. Huh? Yeah. Walking as mere men, you're going to be sensitive to everything that is around you. You're going to be sensitive to another realm. When you're sensitive to an earthly realm and earthly concerns, it literally shuts you down. It, as it were, encases you, as it were, against being able to flow in the anointing of the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Yeah. Hallelujah. I mean, that realm of spirit, I like spending time doing something as much as I possibly can in listening to the older ministers that I can by audio tape or reading something of the older ministers. I just, you know, I'm a link between the past and the future. And I want to make sure that, you know, and I have a hunger there, and the Lord's put that hunger in my life. But, you know, so today I was just listening to all the old things about William Branham, and, you know, just the example of just being willing to walk in the mind of the Spirit and the thinking of the Spirit. He had a big meeting he had to go to, and he had about 2 hours before the airplane left, an hour, hour and a half, something like that. It wasn't a lot of time before the airplane left. So he thought, well, I'm gonna go down and mail something. He walks out of his hotel room and he's gonna go mail something. And the Holy Spirit said, turn around. So he turned around, and the Holy Spirit said, walk. And he walked, and he's walking, and he walked, and he walked, and he walked, and miles and miles and miles, and time has expanded, and the plane has gone. And so then he just started singing one of the old hymns, saying, Lord, how long do you want me to walk? He said, I'm over here in this neighborhood. And the Holy Spirit said, think nothing of it. Do as I told you. He's one long singing song. And then a woman hollers out and says, Parson, Parson. He turns to her and he says, how did you know I was a preacher? She said, because I've been praying since 3 o'clock in the morning. I started praying at 3 o'clock in the morning. My son's laying in there dying. And he said, you remember the Shunammite woman? She said, that's me. Preacher came. I couldn't have a baby. Preacher came, laid hands on me. I had a baby. And now my son, who may see backslid, and he's laying in there dying. The doctor says there's nothing he can do. We're just trying to keep him comfortable as he convalesces, as he passes from this life to the next. And he's on his way to hell. She said, early in the morning, as I was praying, crying out to God, the Lord told me he was going to send me his servant. And I've been standing out here waiting for you most of the day. Just looking, watching. Wow, that's just a natural consequence of relationship, of hunger, of letting God be God, of having something. Because I'm going to tell you right now, I watch too many people get stuck in a performance-based thing, trying to have gifts of the Spirit, and it's just going to shut you down. It's going to shut you down. It isn't a sensitivity to the flow of divine glory. It's an ambitious thing that which you're going to draw now self-worth from. Stop it. That is wrong. You ain't going nowhere with that. And that's really a whole lot of what I've been trying to tell you. Help to deal with, you know, the things that are struggle. Help to deal with the things that would hinder you. Help the things deal with things that would cause confusion in your life. And just help you to settle out and, wait a minute, Father chooses. And I am so happy with this choice. I think every choice, Father, you're brilliant. Every choice that you make is great. And I am so happy and I am so blessed that you anointed so-and-so with such a beautiful anointing and that you placed them in the position that you placed them in. You just make the right decisions every time. I mean, don't you just talk to the Father about like the sunset? Lord, that is amazing. That is excellent, beautiful sunset. Good job, Lord. Do you do that? I do that. I'm not a deist. I don't think it's happening on its own. God did that. He painted it. Whoa! Yes. Nobody can match your artwork, Lord, you know.
That's right.
The heavens declare his glory, you know. Yeah. Hallelujah. And it's wonderful to be able to participate with these things. Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The preacher I told you that stepped out because he just believed if he'd step out and walk on the water and just believe God for it, he'd walk on water. He's never walked on the water. In fact, in many respects, that may have been one of the great upsets in his life where it began to create confusion and doubt because he didn't understand the sovereignty of God. He didn't understand, let every man think soberly. Let no man think more highly of himself than he ought to, but every man understand how to stay right in that place that has been ministered to him by the measure of faith that God had given him, according to the grace of God that has been given, and be happy and be thankful and be blessed, and not try to be competitive with it, or not to try to draw some kind of meaning from it. I'll tell you what you can draw meaning from. You listen to me right now. The witness of the Holy Ghost. And when the Lord talks about his spirit bearing witness with our spirit, we better get happy. When we talk about the fruits of the Spirit, we better get happy. There are certain things where we better be demanding them and yielding ourselves to them, because at the same time, it's training us. And then there's, and just like I told you, I've watched people, you know, like William Brandon, just so sensitive, just so sweet and meek and mild about everything. And as long as they stay sweet and meek and mild, power, the glory of God flows. His strength is revealed in a glorious way in the midst of our weakness and our total dependence upon Him, where we say, I can't do anything of myself. You know, I'm just so happy to be in the number. I'm in the congregation. Praise God. I don't want to take my seat and ascend above the heights of the clouds and exalt myself above the stars of the heavens. I'm not interested in promoting myself in the sun. Are you listening to me over here? I'm interested in doing what God gives and which cannot be mistaken by me. I don't want it to be. I want it to be real. I want it to be divine. I want it to be the divine surge. See, when you demand it to be the divine surgings of the Spirit of the Lord, it's going to be that. When you're stepping out in a human realm, you're never going to know the difference. You're going to get trained wrong. It's going to get messed up. It's got to be a divine surge. You listen to me. You hear me now?
Yes.
Hear me now. That's why it's just that much more important for you to be willing to always have everything examined. You may all prophesy one by one, but everybody else gets to judge. Huh? And then if you get all arrogant and say, wait a minute, you know, my word was accurate. No, the people who know how to flow in the anointing greater than you said that you just stepped out, tried to walk on the water and sank. Bless your heart. Just go and not get discouraged about it. Huh? Did we go ahead and be zealous? Be zealous for spiritual gifts. Covet spiritual gifts. But be willing to be trained. Be willing to be mentored. Be willing to have it submitted. Because if you're not, it's entwined in your ego. It's entwined in a realm of selfishness. It's entwined in a realm that ultimately the prince and the power of the air is functioning in. Anything God's doing by the Holy Ghost, you know, one of the great manifestations of the Holy Spirit is humility. One of the great manifestations of the Holy Ghost is brokenness. Don't tell me you're flowing in the Holy Ghost and there's not the humility there and the brokenness and the meekness and the lowliness. Don't you tell me you're flowing in the Holy Ghost and I get just nothing but a display of stubbornness and arrogance because you're manifesting what spirit you're of. Hello. And then guess what you get to do? Repent. And start and say, I don't know how I let that in, but I'm going to close the door on that. I'm going to recognize that I had too much of my self-worth all wrapped up, not in Jesus, but in performance and what I was doing for Him. Ha, prabo siti ritana mokaya. Ha, shipirene shipodonana mateya. God alone is sufficient for these things, people. Christ Jesus is here confirming the work. It's God that does the work. It's my department to declare the word. It's His department to work the miracles. Hallelujah. It's the Holy Ghost that is here to divide individually and manifest His power and glory through us. It's our position to be submitted and yielded to Him. That is a whole dynamic of relationship that's centered around you and I knowing and believing the love that God has for us. And then in understanding the battlefront that you face. Your battlefront, by and large, is the things that are constantly attacked the realms of your thinking, imaginations. I have people send me emails sometimes, and I'm like, well, all the time. I have a continual flow of, you know, emails, pretty much. And some of them I think, there's an amazing imagination. And because most of the things that go on is within the realms of our own creating them. We took one little piece of something. He frowned. Therefore, you think that I am the devil incarnate. No. But it goes on. You know, it's really, it's no snowballs. The battlefront for all of us is imaginations. The battlefront for all of us is fiery darts from the wicked one. Amen. Creating condemnation that comes right out of the realm, and shame and discouragement right out of hell. How many resist steadfast in the faith? So much, honestly, so much of the battle, so much of the dynamic of what we're going through is just learning how to not allow all these things contrary to the Word of God. Not allow ourselves to think contrary to the things which the Lord has spoken and said about us. And that's there's some heat in that battle. I'll just tell you one of the things I did. Is, you know, when I was young in ministry and I first really began to realize the battlefront of the realm of thinking that would stop the flow of faith and stop the flow of the anointing, the battlefront of condemnation and things of that nature, and this stuff would start hitting me in my thinking, I'd just start shouting to the Lord. I would start praying to the top of my lungs so loud that I was hurting my own ears. You can't think much then. Hallelujah. I learned how to shut it down. I learned how, I think one of the greatest powers and displays of authority in our lives is when we can control every thought that enters our mind. Wow. Yeah. And Father's given us weapons of a warfare, God power to be able to do that. Hallelujah. And we can see before it even becomes a thought whether or not it's from heaven or hell. Before it even begins to distill in our thinking realm, we can see and understand, I can see you coming, you foul thing of hell. Yeah. Huh? Yeah. And then we're not being preoccupied with somebody jabbering our ear when the whole time the Holy Ghost been standing out there and wanting to talk to us. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Both ears, we're getting just all of this information. And we're just walking around all this just jibber-jabber going on in our ears and in our thinking realm. It's just like two people on both sides of it talking as loud as they can, just filling our minds with information. We can't stop listening to them. And if we could just shut them down, we could hear the Holy Spirit speak. That's really what Paul's talking about when he says, you got all these divisions. You got these divisions, you're walking as mere men. You're not walking as spiritual. And Father wants us to leave the realms of just mere men and understand that realm and understand how that comes to play on our lives. And understand, as I was talking earlier, about if you do get involved in all these things, how to get clean of it, how to get free of it, how to get immediately past it, how to then, in getting immediately past it, and that relationship being to where that you got that boldness and confidence towards God, how to then begin to move in a relationship with the Lord where you yourself can begin to experience that transition where the anointing comes upon you. It's flowing out of you. Hallelujah. And you begin to praise, and the anointing of God begins to overwhelm you. You lift your hands, and you feel the presence of the Lord. Many times, I lift my hands, it's almost like totally involuntary. Involuntarily. It's the Spirit of the Son lifts up my hands. And the anointing starts moving, my hands will go popping right up in the air. And it's not a religious, oh, hallelujah. I mean, I'll tell you right now, it's a spiritual thing. It's a supernatural thing. I'm into the supernatural. I'm into the spiritual. I'm into the movings of the Holy Ghost. I'm into the real thing. And the reason I'm in, and I'm not going to let up on the real thing. I'm not going to substitute it with something that I got to have to make me feel better about myself, to make me feel, you know, more secure. I got all the feel better I need, Jesus. I got all the secure I need, Jesus. Hallelujah. I don't care what anybody says about me. I'm not in competition. I'm not being voted on. Hallelujah. I'm not in a show. It doesn't even matter to me, you know. I've got all the approval I desire, all the approval that I want. I want you to have this security in God. I want you to have this fellowship in God. I want you to have this rest in the Lord. I want you to be able then, now, to be able to freely receive all that He freely gives because you're resting in Him. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Hambrete. In all the times, I was so desperate and so hungry for more. Hallelujah. Parase. I live in the thinking about the responsibility that I have to properly represent Him. I'm not going to come. You're not going to see me stand up on the platform all cast down while worship's going on. That would be terrible. Huh? And neither am I up there in showmanship trying to impress everybody. Put on a happy face when my heart's sad. You know what I'm saying? That's a clown act. You know what I'm saying? Are you with me? Uh-uh. There's a transition that I can make. Huh? I don't care what's been coming at me all day long. I don't care what kind of struggles or what kind of situations or what kind of challenges has been hitting me. We all have challenges. And the more you do it and the more you occupy it in the kingdom of God, the more challenges that you're going to have. And you're going to have to learn how to properly deal with them. Otherwise, it'll kill you. Huh? You won't be able to handle it. Well, just learn how to go to Jishiboronasateya. Liberana. You've got to have a place where you consecrated, where you committed. Huh? There's things I won't do. There's things I just won't do on Wednesday that I might do on other days. I just won't do it. Why? Because there's a meeting. There's things I won't do. When I'm Friday night meeting, there's things I won't do on Friday that I might do on other days. I just won't do them. I just want to be that much more sensitive to the Lord. There's things I won't do that I won't do on Sundays that I would do on other days. I just won't do them. I won't do them. I mean, it's the way it is. And then there's times where there's times where I've had to be just running wide open, and the Lord knew it, and nothing I could do about it, and occupied with so many things. But yet I step right into the anointing, step right into the place with God. But if you can just, because there's no formulas here. You see what I'm saying? There is consecration. There's a dedication. There's just, Lord, there's acts of things that we do to say, Lord, I'm just so hungry for you. But the Lord's going to sort it out in our lives. Sort out the motives. He's interested in our eternal souls. He's interested in us having and not having something that's going to destroy us. Amen. You know. If, for example, if the majority of people, if you give them a lot of wealth, it'll ruin them. It'll make them a different person. The people that believe that wealth won't make them different are the people that will be the most different. Because they're so clueless, they're so disconnected from reality. They have such a false impression of themselves. They have so much confidence in themselves. The people that go, yeah, I know, that scares me. That's somebody who's thought about it, who recognizes, wait a minute, I don't have within myself the ability to even know what to do with all of that. Yep. You know, that's, come on, people, walking humbly with your God. It's hard for many people to recognize they can do nothing without Him. That's one of the big struggles. And that's why, yes, the Lord has used many people who are ignorant. Many people with just a seventh grade education. Many people, ignorant fishermen. People who didn't hardly know nothing. People who were really dependent upon Him. People who were like scared. You know, one of the people, I'm not saying people like this, great anointings in their life. And if I'm with them, they go, you go preach. You do it. I'm like, no, you do it, man. No, you do it. No. Because that's just the way they are. And then they get up and power God. Why? Because they just so, within themselves, they have no ability. They're so weak within themselves. There's nothing that they can find within themselves that they're confident in. That's a sensitivity now, a place of yieldedness where God, the Holy Ghost, can just flood in. And so that's why, and so we come back to that, that's why the Lord protects us, you know? I think it was the fiddler of the roof, on the fiddler of the roof, right? If riches is a curse, Lord, strike me with your curse right now. Nah, you don't want that. It might be funny on fiddler on the roof, but curse me, let that curse, and may I never recover. You know, some people, if they were empowered with great anointing signs, wonders, and anointing, that dear brother that I was talking to you about 40 years ago would have walked on the water. As radical as he's lived his life, he was a wild man. I mean, what would have he been like? What would have been like if he would have just inherited that power right there on the spot? It would have ruined him, certainly. It would have ruined a lot of people around him. How many people you know drive their car always in a slide, either to the right or to the left? Huh? First time I ever got in a car with him, he goes up to the railroad tracks, right? Okay? Sets the car right on the railroad tracks and starts burning all the rubber off of his almost brand new tires so he could get the thing down slick enough so he could go into good power slides. This is this guy. I'm telling you. So we're gonna have to help you here, because you are just way too confident in who you are. You're too way too overboard. Can you hear what I'm saying to you? Because I'm really talking about, where do we find that place of rest in Him and just value in what He's done? I mean, there's so many times that we don't know what we got till we lose it. This is the human state. There's so many times that we're blessed with so much stuff, and because our head and our thoughts are so on something else that we think we need, we can't see the multitudes of blessings that we have. And so we're in a state of complaint instead of a state of praise and thanksgiving and adoration. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It's true. It's true, and I face this all the time. We all face it. We face it because we can say, I need more people here tonight. Or I can say, Father, I'm amazed that you've even entrusted me to even be here tonight, and that we have the opportunity to minister to people on the web, and that we have the chairs, and we have even a building to speak in, and I even get to be here in your presence like this. Because if my value system was numbers of people, I would have quit a long time. If I drew my importance and my value out of that, my worthiness, it would be wrong. It would be the wrong system, be the wrong measure. I want you to get that for you, wherever you're at right now, whatever you're dealing with. I want you to get it, just move it right out of the way and get real happy about that you're in the number. Hallelujah. That you get to be in the presence. That you get to be, hallelujah. You didn't choose me. The Lord says, I chose you.
Amen.
That should take all the pressure. I called you and ordained you. My goodness, every one of us, just of that privilege, as many as would receive, He gave them the authority to be sons of God. You have that authority. You may not understand how to move in it. And you don't, maybe, you may, in. But you're going to, and then if you just, maybe you moving in some dimensions of the authority of the Son, and you don't even realize it. You're walking in authority of sonship, and there's a protection, there's a favor, and there's a provision, and it's almost coming like it's just like, it's just so natural and just so common and ordinary that you're not even recognize it as it's coming from the Lord, huh? I mean, the things that people walk around here in America all sad and bummed out about stuff, there's not a person in America that has any rights. I mean, there's people migrating out of Syria right now, been on the road for 14, 15 days, people just walking from Syria to get to Hungary, to get to Europe, and they're out in the weather, and it's getting cold, and it's rainy right now, and they got the little children, the legs are worn out, and they don't have enough food, and hunger is all over them, and they've got no nation, and they've got no place to be. And then that's not even the worst state of people on the planet right now. And we can be so anesthetized by all the blessings that we have that we start getting our focus on things that are just ridiculous. And all the time we're not thankful for what we have, and we should be ecstatic over the peace and the prosperity and the blessing. We should be ecstatic. We should walk in here so happy, like we just got a raise and a new job and given a car and a house, and because we've been given so much. And when we're so thankful for what we have, now we're in a position now to receive so much more. We're now in that position now to be able to move forward in every dimension of life, especially in God.
Amen.
That's why you have to understand it. There's sovereign living God. Father just takes people, grabs them up, says, you're anointed. Signs, wonders, and miracles like nobody's ever had it. They never even asked. Huh? And then there's others of us, we're just desperate for it. I'm hungry. I'm passionate. I'm desirous to walk in the anointing that William Branham walked in. I've never walked in that level of the anointing with that level of exploits. And I'm passionate, but I'm so happy and thankful. My worth is not in it. My worth is in what Jesus did for me. The value and what I believe about Him and believe about myself has nothing to do with that. Has everything to do with what He did for me at Calvary. Has everything to do with what He did when He gave me the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. And in Amasateya, Haroboshia Patea Tishapurinea, in this Thanksgiving, in this place of giving thanks. I'm telling you, this is where the manifest presence of God is able now to grow and mature in our lives. And the more we give ourselves to this praise and this thanksgiving, and if I could just say this once again, you've heard me say it a number of times, it's key to where Daniel walked with God. We're just giving thanks to the Lord three times a day. Wouldn't ask Him or anything, just giving thanks and telling Him how wonderful He is. Even though He was in a place of captivity, in a place of minority group, a persecuted minority group, He was there worshiping the Lord, giving thanks, and look at the promotion that came in His life. It's a spiritual, clear, spiritual message to all of us. Same thing goes with Joseph. Look at Joseph, how he just given thanks and how he was letting God be God. And he was just as confident of God as he ever was, even though he was thrown in the pit and though he was thrown in the prison. He was thrown in the pit, thrown into slavery, thrown into prison. He's just always there, confident, bold about God. He's not letting anything interrupt what he has within the respect of that covenant supplied. And we've got so much more. Now, if you do this, you do this. Hallelujah. You will find tongues, interpretation of tongues so easy. You'll find that manifest presence of God comes so much stronger, so much richer. You'll find and see and discover more miracles, more dreams, more visions, more revelation. I'm telling you, just find it. It's a wonderful thing when you start resting, and that's why Paul said, labor to enter into the rest. Yeah. Amen. Amen. Lest any of you come short. Huh? Hallelujah. Shikato bayashaya. Hallelujah. Well, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, living God. Father, I just thank you for special graces. See, I just believe in special grace. I believe that the Holy Ghost is here, divided and severally, and He wants to work a miracle for you. That the Lord wants to supply things to you that you didn't have when you came in. He wants to equip you with divine abilities that you haven't had before. Hallelujah. He wants to just cause your faith to increase. He's given you a measure, but He wants to increase it. Hallelujah. Ha-ha. But it is to Poranaya. And all that time, we must remember that Paul said, though you have all faith and can move mountains, and you have not love, it profits you nothing. Oh, we've got to understand the importance, the value. We've got to place the value on the most important things, people, dear people. Place the most important value on the most important things. Don't place the most important value on the least important things. Place the most important value on the most important things. Having that love of God, having that richness. It's easy to love when you're being loved. It's easy to be confident when you know how God feels about you. And so ask Father right now, in Jesus' name, in the mighty name of Jesus, that every person in this place come into that wonderful acceptance of the love of God and begin to understand that wonderful flow of heaven upon their life. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Become so accepted in the beloved. Hallelujah. That they know that they're the apple of Father's eye and there's nothing that He won't do for them. Hallelujah. And they don't need any proof either. Amen. Because God's proved it enough. Hallelujah. I tell you, in the name of Jesus, special acts of faith, special works of grace, special signs and wonders, special miracles, special divine abilities and workings of the Spirit of God upon your life. Great peace in Jesus' name. Great peace. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. And he breathed on them. He said, receive the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. And I pray in the name of Jesus that you'll be as you've never been before in reliance upon the Holy Spirit. That when you need that touch of love, for you'll ask him and you'll be able to begin to receive. Or joy or peace or humility or whatever it is. Hallelujah. I mean, I don't know about you, but there's been times where I've had to say, oh, Lord, cause me to walk in humility in this situation. Every fruit of the Spirit I've needed. And hallelujah. Sometimes you need special extra doses. Extra supernatural ability depending upon certain situations. And he's there to supply it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Quickest way to get out of discouragement is giving thanks. Just thanking him. Just thanking him. Just thanking him. Hallelujah. Just thanking him. Hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. Well, in Jesus' mighty name, just be so filled with the Holy Ghost. If there's anything I want all of you to begin to think about and keep in mind, that this special, especially with respect to growing relationship, is just understanding how you can wait on the Lord and begin to experience and know and recognize those same kinds of special abilities to function and minister and be equipped by the Lord, as I was describing with William Branham. Says, well, I'm just as any other man till the angel of the Lord comes. And then he recognized when the angel of the Lord comes, or whether it was him, or as I also talked about Catherine Kuhlman saying, Lord, I don't want to go out there just as any person, but waiting upon the anointing, the whole transition of the atmosphere and the manifest presence of the Lord in her own life, that you understand how you go there as well. So that you can in that way much more function in worship, recognizing if you can just say, somebody said, well, I'm not having to minister, and so, you know, that's not really, I had a person tell me this, more than one person tell me this, well, you know, when I really got the demand to minister on me, I pull on that more. Wait a minute, you got the demand to minister before the Lord. Hallelujah. You need to minister before him, before me, before you minister before men. Huh? And there is a pull upon you for the ministry, because you're going to come and worship and praise him. And if you don't know how to do that by the realms of the anointing, you're missing it. You're missing it. And in that place, the Spirit of the Lord would just equip you too. In so many dimensions of your life, I'm telling you, in dealing with sickness and dealing with weakness of mind and body. Oh, yeah. Praise God. Just do these things. Just do it this way. If you don't understand what I'm talking about, or if you need more clarity on it, I'm happy to talk to you about it. You can email me. I'll help you. And just, you know, ask things. Don't create things that aren't there. But ask things about what you need to have and what Father has for you. And you can grow. Praise God. Presence is so wonderful. Jesus is here. Jesus is here. Holy Spirit is here. His eyes are right on you. I tell you, his eyes are right on you. His affection has been set upon you. And that's something to be continually ecstatic about. Something to be continually ecstatic. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. God is so good. God is so good. Hallelujah. God, he is so good. He is so good to me. Hallelujah. God is so good. He's so good to you. Hallelujah. He's so good. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Makes me feel like dancing. Thank you, Jesus. Praise the name. Praise the name of the Lord Jesus. Well, everybody, just stand with me. Stand with me. And I pray that you just have an awareness and a consciousness, a revelation, insight that you always stand before the Lord, that He's with you, and then He'd never leave you nor forsake you. He's both with you. Christ Jesus is both with you and you. Holy Ghost is both with you and in you. He's very present God. It's wonderful how He emphasized that in time of trouble. Hallelujah. How much more is He present? Hallelujah. In the time of worship, in the time of plenty. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Now, if there's anybody sick in your body, I command you in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth to be healed. In Jesus' name, I break the power of Satan. In Jesus' name, I break the yoke of every unholy thing and must go from you in Jesus' name, according to His word. If anybody's oppressed and tormented of mind, you foul spirit of hell, I break your power right now. You foul thing from the pit of hell. You demon of hell, you oppressive lying spirit of hell, I command you in Jesus' name, loose your hold from off the property of God. Go back from where you came. Do not return. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. According to the word of God, the spirit of God. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name. Kia topana hia. Harababasi. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You can know that God has purposed to impart things to you tonight by His Spirit because He brought you here. When you know you're where God has led you and directed you to go by His Holy Spirit, you can be confident that you're going to get the results that He's promised, that the power and the ability and the provision to meet the need is going to be present. Yeah, because I'm telling you right now, the majority of the working of faith finds itself in the context of the known will of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. We'll find a bunch of people, give them a hug, tell them that you love them in Jesus' name. Amen.